we have something called the nuclear model of the atom, where the atom is composed of a nucleus in the center that contains both the proton and the neutron. And the nucleus is really the bulk of the mass of the whole entire atom. Remember that the proton and neutrons are very heavy relative to the electrons. And the electrons are these cloud that surrounds the nucleus. Now, in the previous model that we talked about, which is the Rutherford model, the electrons are really just particles that spins around the nucleus like the planets orbiting the sun. When we get to topic 7, that's when we're going to talk about the idea that the electrons are really not necessarily the classical particles that we think about, but it's more unique than that. It's sort of a weird type of particle. And so the model of the atom that you want to have in your mind is that there is a nucleus in the middle composed of protons and neutrons, and then the electrons are kind of spread around here around that nucleus. Now, this here gives you some sizes, comparisons of the diameter of the atom, which is much larger than the diameter of the nucleus itself. So you can see that if you compare those numbers, the sizes of those numbers, the atom is about 50,000 times larger in diameter compared to the nucleus, but then the mass of the entire atom is almost all in the nucleus. Okay, so the nucleus is really, really dense. It's a lot of mass in a very small volume. Now, another thing we need to talk a little bit about is how we typically write the symbols for atoms and elements, right? And the way we do this is we have a symbol notation that looks like this, where X here represents the element, and then A here represents something called the mass number, and then Z represents the atomic number. So what are these two numbers right here? Well, atomic number is just the number of protons. And number of protons is like an ID number. It's unique for each element. So if you have a student ID, you know, each student has a unique ID number. Same thing here, each element has a unique ID number, and that ID number is called the atomic number. The mass number is the number of protons and neutrons. Now, why not add the electrons as well? Well, because remember that what contributes to the mass of the atom is the protons and the neutrons. They make up probably 99% of the mass of the atom. So when we try to figure out the mass number, we don't count the electron, not because the electron isn't there, it's there, but it doesn't add as too much to the mass of the atom. Now, isotopes is basically the element that have different numbers of neutrons. Because they have different numbers of neutrons, they give different mass numbers even though they're the same element. So an example is given here. So there's 3 isotopes of neon, isotope 20, isotope 21, isotope 22, and they all differ by the number of neutrons. So this one has one more neutron than that one has one more neutron than this one. Now, why not the protons? Well, because they're all neons. Remember that the atomic number is the number of protons, and that tells you what the element is. So if they're all neons, they all are supposed to have the same atomic number, which means they're supposed to have the same number of protons. The percentage that's given here is something we call the percent abundance, which is something we'll discuss a little bit more in the next topic. But the percent abundance is just how much of a specific isotope is found on Earth. So in the case of neon, the most abundant isotope is isotope 20. There's about 90.5% of it. And then the other two isotopes are not as much. The rarest isotope is isotope 21 because it owns only about 0.3%. Now, what atoms can do is they themselves are neutral, but what happens to atoms is they can lose or gain electrons. Now, why not lose or gain protons? Well, remember that protons are really tightly packed with neutrons, so they're right in the middle of the atoms. The electrons, on the other hand, kind of floating around on the outside. So there's some electrons that are really, really far away from the nucleus, and there's some electrons that are close to the nucleus. The electrons that are really far away from the nucleus is really easy to lose to another atom, or sometimes it's easy to some other electrons to jump onto an existing atom. When that happens, the atoms no longer have equal number of protons and electrons, but an additional electron or fewer electron than what it has before. So these species are called ions. If they happen to be positively charged, they're going to be called cations. In this case, they have more protons than electrons, so they've lost some electrons. Negatively charged ions are called anions. In this case, they've gained some electrons. I want to talk a little bit about the periodic table, just to remind you. The original periodic table was organized as follows, and this was done by Mendeleev. idea, he started by grouping elements with similar chemical properties. For example, elements like sodium and lithium and potassium, they all react with water in the same way, you know, and there are other properties that are very similar with this specific element, so he grouped them in one group, okay? And he started doing that with all the elements known at the time. And then what he did was then he started to organize the elements by their mass. And he said, let's go from the lightest elements on the left and keep going to the right, the heavier elements. And then he puts the element with the same properties in the same column. What's interesting, he found that if you do that, then the mass will repeat. It would end at a specific element and it would repeat again to the first one, which is the one with the same property like the one on the top. And then if you go some number of elements, it would repeat again. And that repeat tends to happen after a specific number of elements. And because there's that repetition, this table that he created is called the periodic table. Periodic means repetitive, right? There's a repetition to that pattern, okay? Now, nowadays, of course, we have a much more complete periodic table that Mendeleev started with, okay? Created, and then we built on it. And now what I want you to know with the periodic table here is just how to get information from it at this point. Later on, we'll talk about why exactly it's organized this way. But right now, we're going to talk about some of the major components of the periodic table. The first is the metals, nonmetals, and metalloid breakdown. So notice that in all periodic table, there's always these lines that are the zigzag lines that separate the right side of the periodic table and the left side. All elements on the left side are metals, and metals have specific properties, like they can conduct electricity, you can shape them, pull them into wires, and so on. The only element that is not a metal on the left side is hydrogen. Hydrogen is a nonmetal. Everybody else on the right side is a nonmetal. The green elements here are metalloid, and actually keeps going down here. So if you draw this zigzag line, the elements that neighbor the zigzag lines are all metalloids, with the exception of aluminum. The other way we read the periodic table is to know what's called a group and what's called a period. So the group are each of the columns in the periodic table. The periods are the rows in the periodic table. Now, the other thing to keep in mind is that some of these groups have special names, as listed here. I'm going to mention what they are. First off, the groups are divided into what we call main group elements and transition group elements. The main group elements are the first two columns and then the last six columns. And then everything else in the middle, the 10 columns in the middle, are the transition. These main group elements, the difference between them and the transition elements is that main group elements are very much more predictable compared to the transition elements. Now, these main group elements have special names. The one in group 1A is called the alkaline metal. The group 2A is called alkaline earth metal. 7A is called halogen, and 8A is called noble gas. The other thing to remember about these is the state of matter that accompanies each of these elements, the natural state of matter. So the ones you want to remember are the liquids and the gases. So there are only two liquid elements. One is mercury and the other one is bromine. There's a number of gaseous elements. Hydrogen is gas. All the noble gases are gas. And then fluorine is a gas. Oxygen is a gas. Nitrogen is a gas. Chlorine is a gas. So those are all the gaseous elements. Now here's another thing to keep in mind, which is that some of these elements are what we call diatomic elements. So what that means is the following. Most of the time, you know, when we look at elements, they're just composed of single atoms that are packed together, right, to make the sample that we have in front of us. But things like hydrogen, for example, they always come as twins. So two atoms of hydrogen stuck together and they travel like that. Same thing with nitrogen, oxygen, fluorine, and chlorine. All of those are diatomic. The noble gases are not. They're monoatomic. So they just come as single atoms. With the liquid elements, bromine comes as diatomic, Br2. Mercury doesn't. It comes as monoatomic. So when you have this twin version of your elements, it's going to be written with the subscript 2. Everybody else is a solid. That's not either a gas or a liquid on the periodic table. So all the metals are solid. All the other nonmetals that are not liquid or gas is going to be solid. So these two are unique. They also are formed by more than one atom. So S8 and P4. So those are all things you need to remember. Compounds are two or more elements, two or more atoms of elements that have combined to make larger things, and they're connected by chemical bonds. And we'll talk a lot more about chemical bonds later on, but they're basically a type of force that's holding two or more atoms together. Now, these atoms, these compounds, can be formed by two types of constituents. They can be formed by ions. So if you have a positive and negative ions combining together, you have something called an ionic compound. It's also possible to make a compound by two neutral atoms that are sharing electrons with each other, and those are called covalent compounds. And again, these atoms are held together by chemical bonds, which is the electrostatic forces that hold atoms together. Now, with ionic compounds, again, remember that there's two things that are bonded together in this case, a cation and an anion. So the cations come from metals. Metals tend to lose electrons, so anything that is a metal in the periodic table can become cations or positively charged ions. And then anything that's a non-metal, which is on the right side of the periodic table, will gain electrons, so they tend to form anions. The main group species have very predictable behavior when it comes to forming ions. So the group 1A metals, they always lose one electron. So you can see the number one here tells you that it's always going to lose one electron. So it tends to form a plus one cation. Group 2A tends to form plus 2 cation. Group 3, plus 3. The nonmetal is the opposite. It's the way you figure them out is by subtracting them from 8. So group 7, if you subtract 7 minus 8, you get negative 1. So that means it's going to gain 1 electron, so it has a charge of minus 1. 6 would be minus 2, and 5 would be minus 3. Okay? And so when you have these ions, like in this case, sodium and chloride, sodium originally has 11 and 11. Chloride has 17 and 17, right? Protons and electrons. What happens is the sodium can donate one of those electrons. So now it only has 10 electrons. So it has a plus one charge now because there's more proton than electron. The chloride gains that electron from sodium and now it has 18 electrons. So it has a negative one charge. That sodium ion and chloride ion can combine together to form the ionic compound shown here. Now, ionic compound, as it happens, don't just form like between a plus one and minus one and just stay two of them together like that, but they actually form this larger unit called a lattice. And so it's never just two of them combining together. Now, a covalent compound, on the other hand, like hydrogen, is just like that, just a unit of two things or three things combining together. Now, what's the difference between ionic and covalent compound? With covalent compounds, they are made up only of nonmetal elements, just all nonmetal. Okay, they get close enough together so that they can share their electrons with each other, and then they form that compound. We typically call them molecules. That's another name for covalent compounds. Now, you can have molecules with the same elements combining together, or you can have them with different elements. So these are just some examples of covalent compounds that are formed by the same and by different elements. There's another species that you need to know about, which is called the polyatomic ions. So polyatomic ion is a covalent species. They're held by covalent bonds, but when they form the larger covalent compound, that covalent compound either gains or loses electrons. And as a result, the entire thing now has a charge on it, and because it has a charge, we call it an ion. So it's a polyatomic ion because it has more than one atom, but it's also an ion. So poly means many, okay? These are some of the ones that I'll talk in the next video. You have to remember their names, and that also goes along with how to name ionic and covalent compounds.